Mario, welcome.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction. I'd like to start by saying thank you to Rashid for inviting me to this event. I really enjoyed the conference, and it's been great to meet all and new friends, as I said several times. As I was introduced, I'm a computer scientist, and I think that will kind of give you a bit of a sense where I wanted to focus my presentation, which is in this part of my kind of title, right, the computational tools. And I'll try to take you through a bit of a journey. I mean, maybe reflecting on the previous presentation, I was lucky to be at the Sanger Institute when we received the first, what it was then, the Solexa machine, which is around 2006, 2007. And what we've seen since then in terms of technology development has been really impressive. And, you know, that had to be accompanied by developing of new computational tools, new algorithms. And I'll focus a bit on that in my presentation. I'm working at NIAP in, we're based in Cambridge, and I think a kind of very simple way of describing what we do is by looking at our tagline, which is translational research is plant science into practice, as we said. Before I move into my presentation, I wanted to mention one collaboration we have with ICRISAT, which is on nitrogen usage. This is a Newton-funded project. We had a couple of months ago an annual meeting here at ICRISAT, which I couldn't attend, unfortunately, and I'm very happy to be here today. And you have seen some of the posters which are reflecting on this international collaboration that has ICRISAT as one of the leaders. Now, right, coming back to what I wanted to tell you, now putting a bit of a set in the scene, we are living in a changing world, and I think there are three, perhaps, pillars that are marking this modern progression. One is access to technologies, and we've seen many, many presentations reflecting on that. Sequencing is just one example. We've seen other advances. The fact that we can connect the technologies, I think, is an important point as well. And that's something which we can consider to be relatively new. Technologies tend to come first, and then how we connect them is always a bit of a challenge. And then underline on this is how we can make this work together, right? And you know, science in this context is really multidisciplinary. And that's been good for me because coming from mathematics and computer science, that gave me a chance to apply my skills into an area of which is really advancing very, very fast. Now, I think we can say the future is here, and I don't want to spend too much time on these different technology advances. I think we haven't maybe heard much about single-cell genomics, but, you know, all the others have been mentioned in one way or another. Portable sequencing, that's really impressive. I heard today that we can now use nanopore sequencing with mobile phones. But, you know, we kind of all agree that although the future is here, the interpretation of the data we can collect with these technologies still a challenge, right? And that's where, you know, I like this slide here, because that's what we do very much in bioinformatics and computational biology. We try to, you know, connect pipes and not just connect the pipes, make sure that we label them with the right colors, right? And sometimes, I mean, I cannot see here, but sometimes we put the wrong colors and that's where things don't work. Now, trying to perhaps put a bit of an abstraction behind all this, that's the way I see big data bioinformatics. We have all these technologies that let us collect data inexpensively. I think we can say now that it's more affordable and this is something which we've seen as a good advance. And having said that, we've seen some presentations today where we still need to put more effort in trying to make these technologies cheaper. And there is this first step where we're trying to reduce that massive data into information, and that's where the focus moves from efficiency into quality, right? And that information is the first, if you like, important step to be able to then apply knowledge to a specific application. And I think a typical example is doing genotype to phenotype studies, where we tend to, you know, get a, you know, interesting experiment, which in general is defined by a large number of samples that we sequence, for example, in this case, to define variants. And that's where we move from, you know, all the millions or, you know, billions of reads into few million SNPs, variants, and it's important that those variants are true variants. That's where, you know, quality comes into play. We want this to be no false positives, for example. And those variants, they're not enough. That's just information that we need to then apply to a specific case of knowledge. You know, for example, if we want to define a trait and make an association with a trait. Now, this is kind of setting up, if you like, the scene of for example, some of the presentations we've seen in the last few days, in order to, just maybe going back, in order to be able to work at this level, we need to have a reference. And, you know, we're moving now from genome to genomes, but we had to have this for genome, and I think, you know, wheat was a great example, and we see Mike's presentation yesterday looking into, you know, taking us through this interesting journey where we could tackle a very complex genome like wheat. I was part of the first initiative where I could say that it was a combination of, you know, the technologies which we had to have to be able to sequence, a bit of a clever approach to take a bit of a divide and conquer, if you like, a strategy to be able to then, you know, get sensible sequence at the end. Now, that was the first step, and it's what you need to be able to do this genotype to phenotype studies, but still, it's a complex beast, right? Still, we need to deal with this needle in a haystack. And what we have come, you know, up through the different kind of approaches and strategies is something which I think Jonathan Jones mentioned the first day. It is ways of trying to pinpoint areas of the genome sometimes it's not possible to get to the genes that could, you know, add some significant advance downstream. In this case, was a work we did with Cristobal Wawi in trying to identify the locus for yellow rust resistance, the number 15, through a bit of a bulk segregant approach, and by the fact that we had an underlying genome, you know, through, you know, sequencing, in this case of RNA-seq data, we could, you know, pinpoint a region where we can now define better markers. Actually, subsequently from this work, another group managed to really identify the underlying gene. What I wanted to mention in this case is that this, you know, specific biological problem, if you like, which has a specific application, kind of drive us to develop a new tool. And this is something which we did with my PhD student, where through the need to be to having to identify, in the case of the hexaploid wheat, markers which could be subgenome specific, we develop a tool which we call polymarker that can now be used to design primers for polyploid species. And I wanted to mention that this. An example where, you know, an application, if you like, a problem in biology, help us to develop an application that can be used in other contexts. Now, staying still on the, if you like, the single genome level, I wanted to mention another, if you like, problem which we want to tackle, which is being able to identify genes which are linked to apomixis. As I put in my title, I am looking for better crops. Apomixis, if we could manage to identify genes underlying apomixis, we could, you know, get into a position where we could, for example, get seed production, clonal seed production, if you like, and it would bring many, many more benefits. In this case, it's a collaboration I have with a group in Argentina. They are working with a model for apomixis, which is a grass called weeping love grass. What we are trying to do is, in this case, is through looking into the plants which show the apomictic trait and compare them with the plants that they don't have the trait and is within the same species, try to identify the what we expect will be a reduced number of genes that we can then manipulate to be able to get apomixis, if you like, at will. Right? And very much perhaps reflecting on what Dave presented in the previous talk, if there are a reduced number of genes, who knows, maybe we could look into something like genome editing to regulate and manipulate apomixis. In this specific case, the grass is a tetraploid. We managed to get a diploid through some manipulation, and what we are trying to do now is generate a genome for this species. Again, another example that if we have a genome, we should be able then to go after the genes and, you know, hopefully move forward here. Now, this is just to tell you what we are with this genome. This is something which we haven't published yet. It's a sensible genome. We're expecting to improve it. This is yet kind of expectation in trying to improve the length of the context. We are trying to bring some of the high-C technologies that was presented yesterday. But, you know, we have now enough to be able to identify some of the genes which can be linked to forage quality, right? And that's an example here of one of the lignin biosynthesis which we have identified by having that genome. Now, this is maybe a good point to move from, if you like, a single genome to many genomes. It was said before that diversity is very important for breeding, and I don't want to dwell too much into that because it's been a theme during the different presentations. Diversity is great for many reasons. It's great because it brings traits that could be hosted in wild relatives. There are many ways we can get to diversity. I think we've seen many presentations that have been focusing on natural diversity, but you know, we do have now tools that could let us as well play a bit with a more perhaps induced way of generating diversity. And I think tilling is a well-known approach, as well, it was mentioned before, genome editing and synthetics as well. Now, in that space, I've been working on a RISE project trying to identify like novel variants within a very exclusive set of samples coming from a Vietnamese national collection. One perhaps interesting point to kind of highlight here is that the motivation to look into these samples is that Vietnam is under a lot of pressure to tackle the issue that's coming from salinity, right, with raising sea levels. Now, the objective of this project, which is funded by the Newton Fund and BBSRC, is to try to look through the collection, which is currently, you know, available, if you like, to Vietnamese growers, to samples, varieties that could have alleles, which could be beneficial to tackle the issue of salt tolerance, and as well, other pests which are linked to climate change. Now, we started with around 600 different lines, and now, again, focusing, if you like, on what I wanted to do in this presentation, we had to put together a bit of a pipeline. You could see that through this pipeline, we start by processing the reads. Now, there is a first step where we generate like a number of putative variants, which is around 5 million at this level. And through different polishing steps, we get to the final set, which is around 800,000 SNPs. With that kind of, if you like, a landscape of diversity, we can start to look into downstream analysis. And the first one is trying to look into how we can place all this diversity in a structure that could be simplifying an abstraction, if you like, to be able to compare the different varieties. And what we did this kind of principal coordinate analysis where we can place, if you like, all these 600 odd samples into this 3D space. And we see very quickly that there are, you know, different subsets. You know, there's some kind of logic behind this information. And the next step was to try to label this, looking into, you know, the Japonica indica sub, if you like, population that was mentioned by several speakers before. Maybe one point to highlight here is this is using some of the tools developed by the James Hutton Institute, and I guess David Marshall might mention this in more detail later, but it's great to have these tools to be able to look into the data and play with the data. As soon as we put a bit of color into this in terms of the Indica Japonica, we see, you know, a clear division, but as well we see that there's been some mislabeling of the samples, right? A typical example where by doing genomic data we can get more information. Now, I'd like to move quickly into how we can use diversity data for other applications, and I've been part of the ASH DIVAC effort in the UK. This is a disease that is affecting ash trees. It's coming from the east, and it's been coming through many years through different waves. It got to the UK in 2012. It's been devastating in places like Denmark, where many trees have been destroyed. And what I wanted to bring to kind of the discussion today is that through diversity, we expect that we can hopefully breed from some tolerance to the disease. In our project, we identify markers. My point to highlight, which is relevant to diversity, is that if we're going to be breeding for tolerance, we need to make sure that we preserve in that breeding what would be the natural diversity we had before, right? And that's very much what was the objective of our project. And again, an example where we move from a single genome to many genomes to be able to move forward. Now, coming back to the computational, if you like, aspects of having to deal with all this information, the previous speaker mentioned the Broglie graphs. This is very much one way of identifying that a genome is not just a single, if you like, string or line, that there is some structure. And what we have here is the Broglie graph for a small genome. This is E. coli, and I picked one that I could put in one slide, but that's the main reason. But you see that, you know, that doesn't look like a single line. There is some structure. And what we're trying to do with this kind of approach is try to represent information in a way that all this structure is visible, right? And coming back to the point of the pan genomes, is about bringing, if you like, more than one individual in the same graph in a way that kind of rich diversity in you know, variation at the level of perhaps a single base or a structural variation could be evident. And it's something which we started to kind of play with a few years ago, and now it's becoming more and more relevant. And we will start to see tools for which we could represent individuals in this kind of graph structure, not necessarily the Broins, and I agree with David that maybe the Broin graphs is not the best approach, but it's a way where we could start to see, for example, things like, you know, single SNPs, which will create this kind of shape in the graph, or more complex insertions, and you will get this kind of shape in the graph. Now, just going towards perhaps the second half of my presentation, and still focusing on those tools for breeding, and maybe reflecting on some of the presentation we've seen before. You know, it's about genomics, but it's more than genomics. It's sometimes bringing other things together. And although, you know, we don't expect this to be a good example of best practice, right, that a single switch will change different things, the truth is that when it comes to work in biology, we need to take care, and it's relevant as well for things like genome editing, that when we modify, you know, single bases in the genome, we might have unexpected effects. What I wanted to move now is to a more kind of recent work I've been doing in the spirit of translational science that has been focusing on mostly agronomy. And I think what I wanted to do is to see how we can perhaps bring agronomy and genomics together, which is part of the challenge we will see in the next few years. And in this specific case, I will focus on what I've been doing with potato modeling. Now, to put this into a bit of a context, looking into the yields in the UK in potato, we've seen has been, you know, fairly kind of uniform over many, many years. Since the 60s, roughly, we are growing less than 6 million tons of potatoes in the UK. Just to put this in a bit of more kind of global context, China is now growing 100 million, and India is the second largest in the world with around 45 million. But when you look into this picture, something which is maybe a very kind of good news, and it's kind of very reassuring, if you like, for our community, is this second curve where we see, if you like, that the yield has been increasing steadily. Right? Now, there are 2 points here in this diagram that should kind of be highlighted, which is the 70s, 76, and then the 2012. Well, I can say that I'm not maybe old enough to remember what happened here, but some of you might know, in particular the UK, the British people. That was a very, very hot summer. We actually had a couple of very hot years, which really had this huge impact in yield. And 2012, which I remember very well, there was actually the opposite, right? Now, there was this two extreme, if you like, weather events that affected yields dramatically in these two years. But coming back to the good story, which is the increase in yield, this bean map by, if you like, corresponding decrease in use in planting area, which is actually directly related to the fact that we can grow more potatoes using less. And part of less land, right? And part of that revolution came from the fact that we could understand, if you like, the agronomy of potatoes. It's a genomic gain, if you like, in some way, but I think we haven't seen enough yet, but understanding how we can manage, if you like, yield predictions much, much better. And I've been personally working on a project that is coming from a work done by Cambridge University Farm, which is now part of NIAP, where we develop a model that is looking into canopy development of potato plants as a kind of a key input for what we can do downstream in being able to predict yields. Now, putting this into a more kind of mathematical presentation, we have this kind of, if you like, presentation of the data where we plot canopy development or growth, you know, it's going to be stable, almost 100% cover, and then there is a senescence, if you like, of the crop. And we plot this against what in this case is shown as the solar radiation, right? And you can see, you know, sometimes in the UK you have really depressing pictures of a full week of rain and not much sun. And you see how this is going downhill when it comes to, you know, close to Christmas. Now, what we do with this kind of model is through the capacity of the plant to capture, if you like, solar radiation, we can predict what's the red line, which is the yield. And we have done this in a very effective way because it's not just the yield, we can also predict what's going to be the distribution of tuber sizes in the crop, which is a key component when it comes to negotiating contracts for growers. And maybe this is pointing to one of the things that the minister said the first day. How can we make sure that we support growers to get and improve margins on their crops? And that's a great example of an application that will support that. Now, in terms of how we do this, and I think that's the beauty of the system, it's a very simple way of collecting the data. We collect the data through just taking images, and we use actually mobile phones. We can use all the most sophisticated systems, but it's, the cost doesn't justify, if you like, the improvements on the predictions. We take pictures and we plot them through what we expect, if you like, as a reference curve for canopy. And this kind of approach let us, for example, try to, we can, for example, detect crops which could be underperforming, which we have here up in the first diagram. You know, we have a expected curve for that variety, and in this specific case, there is a bit of a gap, and that gap will have a direct impact on what's the yield for that particular crop. We have as well sometimes the opposite, and that's what we have in the diagram down here. And this is something which happened in particular this year in the UK, is that we had a very good initial part of the season, which meant that crops could take, they did a better, if you like, job at taking nitrogen that was available or it was provided. And what we've seen, and it's very hard maybe to see from the back, but that our prediction of the canopy is kind of falling short to what actually we are observing, which means that this crop will actually produce, you know, more yield that we can even predict precisely. And actually, that's what we've seen this year in the UK, and that's why the price of potatoes is going to be very low, because it's going to be an over offer over the demand. As I said, we capture our images using a very simple method, which I think that's part of the beauty of the system. Everyone has a mobile phone. We take this kind of mask, and that's where we compute the canopy of the, I mean, the coverage of the canopy with respect to the ground. And when I took, I mean, I just wanted to mention this because there is a bit of a caveat. When I was looking into this picture, there was something here which didn't make any sense, which is all these two blobs here. And I saw it on this specific crop many, many times. You expect to have the crop in the middle and nothing else. And then when I look into more closely to the picture, you can see what was happening here. The guy who was taking the picture was putting actually his feet over here. Anyway, that would have had an effect on the canopy, but anyway, we can actually manage that through looking into, you know, cleverly that, you know, this doesn't belong to the canopy. Now, the other thing which I mentioned, which we do with this model, which is quite unique, and I think that's where the added value is coming into play, is the fact that we can predict the, if like, partition of the crop into different tuber sizes, and that's what's used by growers as kind of a strong tool to be able to sell their potatoes. There is a point where if the potatoes are the tubers are too large, they don't really get any good price for that. And what they tend to do is, looking into this prediction, burn down the crop before they start to see tubers at this kind of bracket. It's another important tool. Now, we are running this model in a very flexible way. We have a bit of a kind of what we call back-end front-end approach, where we have the model running behind an API. It's part of making sure that we can connect the model to different interfaces, and we present this through different applications. We are working, for example, in Cambridge with an Indian company, actually, called Kisan Hub, that they're providing the face of this service. Now, looking into that, I have only 1.5 minutes, and it is great because I have only one more slide left. Very much what I wanted to do in my presentation is talk to you about the personal journey coming from, if you like, genomics, bioinformatics, into how we can make sure that that can be applied in specific real examples like the potato model. Clearly, there's more we need to do. That was highlighted by many speakers. I don't think I need to say much more on that. But I wanted to use a quote from Paul Nurse that was published almost 10 years ago, sorry. And what he said at that point is that, you know, we need to focus more on the information that is managed by living systems, right? And what he highlighted as being still something that we need to work more and is very close to computer scientists, if you like, that we don't have yet the right language to describe the information. And I think this is something which was presented by different speakers, and I was really pleased to see that this is something which I think we need to work more. I mean, this is molecular biology and genomics is still very young as an area of science, and, you know, if we have the right language, we should be able, in the future, to be able to, what sometimes called, you know, define the logic, which could give us, if you like, tools to to be able to do more in silico biology. And I think that's going to be very, very important for example, some of the applications we've seen today, like being able to predict what modification in the genome can do downstream. Right, okay. No, thank you very much. Yeah. Oh, wow. As you can see, I rehearsed the timing very, very well.
Mario has perfectly timed it. Okay, questions? Yeah, Dr. Siddiq.
Thank you for that interesting presentation. I probably missed, you had talked about the genomics, and then you showed the agronomy, the modeling, which is, has been going on for a long time. Where is the connection between genomics and the modeling in relation to tuber production, partitioning, etc.? I may have missed.
No, I think you're right, and I think I haven't said much about that because that's what we still need to work more. I mean, put more work. I think the presentation that the first presentation of the conference by Jonathan, when he was showing all these different genes which bring resistance, I think what we need to make sure that those genes get into growers as quickly as we can. And I don't think we need to do more there, right? I mean, it's an optimistic message I want to pass, but what we see is that, you know, we still have a bit of a gap, and I wanted to kind of emphasize, if you like, that gap through my presentation. That's why I didn't say much about that part in the middle. Yeah.
Regarding phenotyping by imaging, you were showing some pictures. And so the biggest challenge coming up is very easy to collect a lot of good data in a very fast and quick way. But when it comes to processing, there is a lot of issue. And the biggest issue is these ghost images. Like, you know, very difficult to distinguish between shoes and canopy, right? So in your view, where we are in that way and how effectively we can handle this kind of issue? Is there tools and systems available for
that? I think just perhaps to make a bit of an analogy, we are today with phenotyping what we were 10 years ago with sequencing. But you know, the difference is with phenotyping technologies is that we have many more, if you like, approaches to like the parameters we are looking at is much bigger and the search space is bigger. I think that's where we are. But maybe one point I wanted to kind of reflect is that, unfortunately, but I think I understand why, most technologies are developed bottom-up. People come with the idea of a new technology, they deploy it, and they think about the data and how the data can be used in the context of other tools as a secondary point. And I think that has been a bit of a challenge for us because we need to, you know, get with all these different data sets and maybe, you know, connecting them and label them in a way that is sensible. And we spend a lot of time doing translation and mapping of data. And I think it's part of the nature and how technology develop, but I think it's something which we could perhaps be more strategic. It would be good. I think with sequencing, it was similar, but it was easier because the object, although it's a complex object, it's not as complex as all the parameters we have for phenotyping.
Question? I think the imaging of crops, so especially crops like groundnut, a peanut, wherein the pods will be developing under the ground. What are the possible tools to develop technologies to screen groundnut to underground? Developing stages of groundnut, is it possible?
That's a very good question. I think with potatoes, you can use actually the same analogy. But the thing about potatoes is, which I didn't say, and as you might have said, is what we did is kind of benefiting for 20 years of research on potato varieties and potato physiology, and that's a tricky thing. We tend to have models which are associations, if you like, probabilistic rather than mechanistic. And the good thing about our potato model is that this is mechanistic, right? There's a direct translation between solar radiation and canopy into carbohydrate production. And I think that's it's been great that we could get there, but it took many, many years. And I think we need to balance, right, the two different approaches. Right? Mm-hmm.
One final question, if there is any. If not, let's give a big hand to Mario for his
excellent lecture.